Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, we thank you for the blessing you've given us for being your children. We thank you that you have accepted us to be your sons. Father God, you are our Father, and we want to know more about you. And this is why we come to this Bible study, to hear from you, Lord, to get to know you better, to understand how we can make you happier as we go through our walk with you. So, Lord, just open our hearts, open our spirit, and let us receive your words in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, last week, we saw that the Sadducees, they didn't believe in the resurrection. But they gave the question to Jesus about the resurrection. Even though they didn't believe in it, they gave him a question about it so they could try to trap him. They didn't care anything about it, but they asked him just so they can try to trap him. And they asked him about a woman who had a husband, died, and didn't have no children. So she ended up marrying the rest of his brothers. And they all died, and she had no children. And they asked him, well, whose wife is she going to be when she gets to heaven? And the Lord, and Jesus said, there is no marriage in heaven. And I showed last week why there's no marriage in heaven. Why there's marriage now. The reason there's marriage now is because God wants marriage, a husband and wife, a godly husband and wife, to have godly children. That's why we have marriage now, because he wants to have godly children. I showed that last week. He said, those that are counted worthy, Jesus said that those that were counted worthy would go to heaven. He said, like the angels, that we'd be like the angels. Well, the angels never die. Angels never die. The heavenly angels. Now, we got the fallen angels. They're never going to die. They will die spiritually when they go to hell and burn forever and ever. But the angels that are still in heaven, they're never going to die. And the Lord says, we're like them. We're like them because once we become born again spiritually, we're never going to die, just like the angels. Amen. That's what he said that we learned last week. Now I'm going to start in verse 37 of Luke chapter 20. Now that the dead are risen, even Moses showed at the bush when he had called the Lord, the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob. Now, I'm going to read the same thing, the same account, but I'm going to read in Matthew chapter 22, verses 31 and 32. In Matthew, it says, but as touching the resurrection of the dead, have ye not read that which was spoken unto you by God, saying, again, Jesus is going to use what they said in verse 28 about Moses, what they said about Moses, since they believed in him. And Jesus says, y'all are scholars. They're scholars, religious leaders. They know the scriptures. He says, have you not read? We're talking about religious leaders. Jesus says, have you not read? Don't you read the Bible, the scriptures? Back then, it was the Old Testament scriptures. He was showing them how they didn't understand the words of God. Get the picture. Jesus is talking to religious leaders. It's pretty much almost the same today. I've already told y'all about that. In verse 37, it says, Moses, when he spoke to God, called him the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob. But here in Matthew's account, it makes it clear on what he has proven. God is saying in verse 32, I am God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob. God is not the God of the dead, but of the living. Amen. Those were Christian men. He's the God of those men. But he's not the God of the dead. And we're not talking about just physical dead. We're talking about spiritually dead. God is not the father of the spiritually dead. If they had not... Not if they have not, but since they didn't even believe in the resurrection, these are religious leaders. They didn't even believe in the resurrection. when God was talking to Moses, and he told Moses, well, Moses asked him, who do I tell the people who sent me? And God told Abraham, tell them, I am sent you. God is I am. I am the God of Abraham. I am the God of, these are Christian people. I am their God. I am. Jesus is I am. I am whatever you need is what he's saying. Whatever you need, I am. Amen? Those little words, I am, makes a big difference. To understand every word, I've showed this before, every word, A, the, I, every word in the Bible has a meaning. There are no wasted words in the Bible. You think, I am, you know, I am, you know, it's just, I am. No, I am has a big meaning. All the words in the Bible have big meanings. The Lord didn't waste any words in the Bible. None. Then he comes out and just tells them. He tells the religious leaders in verse 38, for he is not a God of the dead, but of the living. For all live unto him. Then certain of the scribes answered and said, Master, thou hast well said. We see here that Jesus did reach some of the leaders. He did reach them. Because they said, they told him, that was good what you said. That is true what you said. That's what they were saying. They believed what he said. So, religious leaders, yeah, they can be reached for the Lord. But many of them can't because they think they're there already, just like these guys did. Yeah. They think they're there already. When they said master this time, you know, all the other times they were just being hypocrites about it, calling them master. But this time, they meant it when they called him master. In verse 40, and after that, they dost not ask him any questions at all. Again, how many times have they did that? Oh, shoot, we're not going to say anything else to this guy. he has an answer for everything we throw at him. And when they saw that they couldn't trap him, that was it. Because he showed more wisdom. Jesus showed more wisdom and knew more than the religious leaders, that's for sure. He said, religious leaders, come on. I mean, you're thinking about the religious leaders of today. They're not much different. I've told you that already. There's a lot of wolves in the church. The Bible speaks about wolves. So there's a lot of preachers out there that are just like these religious leaders. They don't know. They don't know the word of God. This man, like I said, who was not a scholar, he didn't go to college, he didn't go to seminaries, didn't have letters before his name or after his name, no titles, had the believing, he had the people believing in him more than the religious leaders. People believed in him more. And he didn't wear the outfit. And he didn't act like a religious leader. Jesus was just a regular man amongst the people, but he knew the word of God. He walked in the Spirit. He was led by the Spirit. Amen. And that's what kind of religious leaders we need today. And there are some out there, but there are many that are not. He was just a carpenter. Can you see that? He was just a carpenter, a regular man. If Jesus was to come into our church today, people wouldn't accept him. Well, who are you? Well, they'd be doing the same thing to him as they're doing to me. What do I know? You know, where's your degrees? Where's your college? Where's your seminaries? Sorry, I'm only led by the Spirit. Amen. The next story is in Matthew's chapter 22. And Mark 12 and Luke 20. We'll look at all three of these and get a full understanding of what he is saying here in these next story. Matthew chapter 22, verse 35. Then one of them, which was a lawyer, asked him a question, tempting him and saying, Now, this is what Matthew says. They said, then one of them, which was a lawyer. So we see that a lawyer is asking them a question. Now, if you go to Mark chapter 12, verse 28 through 34, it says, and one of the scribes came and having heard them reasoning together and perceiving that he had answered them well, asked them, which is the first commandment of all? So by reading these two verses, we see that he's a lawyer and he's a scribe. And both those scribes and lawyers were very intelligent men back then. We're talking about intelligent men. They didn't have the intelligence of the Lord, the wisdom of the Lord, but in man's eyes, they were very intelligent. And the scribe, which is from the bloodline of the Levites, which we know what comes from the Levites, priests. And verse 29, it says, and Jesus answered him, the first of all the commandments is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. Here it says, the first of the commandments. In Matthew's it says, which is the great commandment? So he's asking Jesus, which is the first and great commandment of them all? Like I said, when you read Matthew's, Luke, Mark, and John, each one puts a little different in there. In Matthew's, it said lawyer. In Mark, it said scribe. So he was both. And then they says the first commandment. One says is the great commandment, and one says it's the first of all commandments. So when you put the scriptures together, those four gospels, when you read them all four together, you get a better picture of what's going on during this time with Jesus. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment. When Jesus says that the second is like the first, he's saying they're equal. That's what he's saying. They're equal. One's great, one's the first. I mean, they're equal. That's why I had a teaching on how to read the Bible, how to read the scriptures, because we miss it a lot of times. In Matthew's, he adds a little bit to it. Matthew's 22:40. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. If you love the Lord with all your heart and your neighbor as yourself, it covers the laws and what the prophets had said. That covers all of it right here. Just that. On these two commandments hang all the laws and prophets. Those two verses, I could do a teaching just on those two verses by itself. A whole teaching on that. I'll give you an example. When the scriptures say, thou shalt not murder, well, that's already been obeyed because you love everyone. You love everyone and so on. Thou shalt not murder. So if you're not going to murder anybody, it's like it says, excuse me, we're love. He is love, and we're love is his biggest commandment, really. Love. And if we love, this is automatically going to happen. Like I said, there's scriptures in the Bibles that are not commands anymore. They're promises. So we love everyone, like the Lord said. This is a promise. We're not going to kill anybody. Amen? Yeah, that's good. The problem is we put ourselves first. That's our problem. We put ourselves first. And that's why we have a hard time obeying some of the commandments. When we have a hard time obeying them, now listen to me, when we have a hard time obeying the commandments, it's because we're not walking with the Lord. It's because we're doing it in the flesh. When you're in the flesh, you have a hard time keeping the commandments. But if you're walking in the Spirit, it just comes automatic. I hope you hear what I'm saying. In verse 32, and the scribe said unto him, well, Master, thou hast said the truth, for there is one God, and there is none other but he. And to love him with all the heart and with all understanding, and with all the soul, and with all the strength, and to love his neighbor as himself, is more than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices. Now, this is the same thing that was said in the Old Testament. 1 Samuel 15:22. And Samuel said, Hath the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifice as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than to sacrifice. Obey. And to hearken than the fat of rams. Listen is better. Obeying is better than any kind of sacrifice or offerings you can make. Say you tie 10% to the church, but you don't obey the commands of the Lord. Do you think the Lord's going to bless you for tithing? He don't care about tithing. What he wants more than tithing is obeying him. So people who tithe to the church and they're not walking with the Lord, they're not obeying him, they're just wasting their money because he is not going to bless them. He will bless you like he says in Malachi. He will bless you. But the first thing he wants is you walk with him, to follow him. Amen? Verse 34, and when Jesus saw that he answered discreetly, he said unto him, Thou art not far from the kingdom of God. And no man after that does ask him any question. Jesus is saying right here that this is a very intelligent man. This is a religious leader. But he wasn't far from God, because this man said, you tell the truth. You tell the truth. Now all this man has to do is receive it. He recognized that Jesus is the truth. That's why he said, you're not far. You're not far from the kingdom of God. They quit asking him questions after that. They quit asking him questions. They were scared to. I would be too. If I'm trying to trap somebody and everything I throw at him, he's got an answer for it, I'm just going to say, oh man, forget it. And because of them trying to trap him, he ended up trapping them instead. I showed that over and over, making them look like they had no knowledge, which they didn't. Because Jesus told them, don't you know the scriptures? So they had no knowledge. They had no knowledge of God. Oh, they had knowledge. They knew who God was, but they didn't know him. Remember the teaching I had? There's a difference between knowing someone and knowing somebody. Like I said, Brandon, you know me. But my wife knows me because she lives with me. So there's a difference. You know about me, but my wife knows me. And that's them. They know about God, but they don't know him.
Like they heard, but they didn't listen.
Yeah. They were scared to ask Jesus any more questions. Because he kept coming back. Jesus had the knowledge of God. God gave Jesus the knowledge. Like I said last time, the gift of wisdom and the gift of knowledge. This is what we receive when we're walking in the Spirit. We receive God's knowledge and his wisdom. Just like he did with Jesus. And I said last week, Jesus was given the word of knowledge. He was given the word of wisdom on how to answer these questions. He got it from the Lord. So when we're in the world, we have to depend on the Lord to give us the answer. If we're walking with him, we're in the Spirit, then we will be led by the Spirit, which will be God letting us know what to say. Just like he said, don't worry about what to say. I will give you the words to say. Amen. They have any more to say to him. They left. Jesus left them speechless. Really, he left them looking like fools. In fact, the Lord says that. But yet in 2 days, they will put him to death. After Jesus answered with wisdom their questions, showing them who he was. Not just showing them, but I showed you all through this teaching. He plainly said several times, I am. I am. And these religious leaders still wanted to put him to death, and they did. You know what a wolf is? a wolf is a man or a woman who goes against the words of God, who wants to kill the words of God. They don't want to give you the truth. Because if they give you the truth, then they're giving you life if you accept it. Amen? Jesus gives us life. Now we're going to see, it's Jesus' turn to ask the questions. Same story, but let's go to Matthew 22, verses 41 through 46. While the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them, saying, "What think ye of Christ? Whose son is he?" They said unto him, "The son of David." They're saying that the Christ, the Messiah, is the son of David, which that is right. And they know that's right. But Jesus is going to show them that they don't know nothing. They said that, like I said, it's true. But when you're not accepting Jesus as the son of David, which meaning the great, 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 I don't know how many greats it is, but Jesus is the great, great, great son of David. In verse 43, he saith unto him, "How then doeth David in the spirit call him Lord, saying?" So before I go any further, first he tells them that David is speaking through the Holy Spirit. David is. Remember, in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit didn't come in them. It came on them. So the Holy Spirit didn't come in us until after Jesus resurrected. And he said, "I'm going to send you the Comforter to live in you." Right. But the Holy Spirit was alive in the Old Testament. It just didn't come in and it came on them. So that's why he said it this way. And the Spirit calls the Christ or the Messiah Lord. That's how David did. Then he tells them what David said in verse 44. "The Lord saith unto my Lord, Sit thou on my right hand till I make thy enemies thy footstool." I've told you before, when you see the word Lord in capital letters like it is here, it means Jehovah. God, Jehovah. We see here that David has his God, but then he has another Lord with small, capital L, but small letters. Now, don't let me confuse you. Remember, God, Jesus is the same. Jesus is God in heaven, but Jesus is man on earth, but they're the same. And if that confuses you, I have a teaching. It's called, "Is Jesus God?" Listen to it. Now, right now, God is speaking to him, and this other Lord hasn't appeared yet. 1 John 1:14, "And the Word was made flesh, and the Word was made flesh, which we know in John 1:1, Jesus, "and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." And we know this. We know the Word is speaking about God because of what it says in John 1:1. Now, who is the only begotten of the Father? It says it right here, the only begotten of the Father. Well, those of you who might not understand it, who is the begotten of the Father? Well, it plainly tells us, Hebrews 1:5, "For unto which of the angels said he," speaking of God, "at any time, Thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee." Amen? Now we know who the begotten is. It's the Son. Amen. "And again, I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son." See what you get when you study the Bible? If you're wondering, well, in John, begotten, who's the begotten? Well, let's just keep on reading. Just keep on reading. The Lord will let us. Sometimes he lets us know ahead of time, but then sometimes he lets us know later. And right here, he showed it to us later who the begotten was. It was his son. Now, it says it also in 1 John 4:9. "And this was manifest the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten son into the world." Amen. "That we might live through him." Isn't the Bible fun to read? You can scratch your head and what's that mean? But just keep reading. Yeah. Then when he does show you, you're going, oh, yeah. Amen. In verse 45, if David then called him Lord, how is he his son? Jesus has shown them what a big mistake they have been making. When they said in verse 42 that the Messiah is the son of David, when they said that, they were meaning that he was actually the physical son of David. That's what they were meaning, the physical son of David. Jesus has shown these religious leaders that the Christ is more than just a human. Christ is more than just a human, speaking of himself, that he is Lord. I said, this whole teaching, that's all I've been doing, is Jesus shown them that he was the Messiah, the Son of God, the Son of David, spiritually, you know, and physically, but as a great, 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 great son. But when he says Son of David, he's talking about spiritually, that is his Lord. David calls him Lord. So, now, Jesus has shown these religious leaders through answering their question, and now showing them that he is the Messiah, Son of God, again, but they didn't receive him because of the power they would lose with the people. Being accepted by the people back then with them, and even today, being accepted by people, not Christians, by people. That's why many people don't give their life to the Lord. Because if they do, then they're going to live a different life. Right. Then they're going to lose these friends that they run around with, whether it be partying or whatever it may be. Yeah. They'll lose that. They don't want to lose it. They want to be accepted. And that's why a lot of people don't come to know the Lord, don't want to know the Lord, because they want to be accepted by their friends, which is the world. They enjoy living the way they're living with their lost friends. They enjoy it. And this hinders a lot of people from coming to accept the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. Just like these religious leaders. I'm coming down hard on the religious leaders because, I mean, this whole teaching I've showed you. What are they doing? Right. Verse 46. And no man was able to answer him a word, neither does any man from that day forth ask him any more question. He dropped a bomb on him. That's all I can say. He dropped a bomb on him. And they just couldn't answer them. We'll see in Mark chapter 12, verse 37, it adds to this, the common people heard him gladly. The common people, talking about regular people like you and I, heard him gladly. Religious leaders couldn't hear him, but the common man could. Amen? The people turned from the religious leaders to Jesus. Because Jesus was speaking the truth. He was speaking the words of the scriptures. And that, like I said, Jews know the scriptures. They studied from kids. They memorized the scriptures. So they know. But they didn't know him. But now they've seen Jesus. Now they've seen the words that they've studied. Now they see it in real life. And they have accepted it. Religious leaders, and like I've said all through this teaching, the reason they didn't want to, because they knew, but the reason they didn't want to, they didn't want to lose their popularity. They did not want to lose their authority they had. They liked being worshipped. They liked being looked up to, just like men today. Because of religion today, we have to read and study the Bible ourselves, because our religion, I've been a Christian a long time. I've been in churches. I've listened to them on TV, the Christian station on TV, TBN, the 24-hour station. I don't suggest for Christians to watch that station, because there is some Christianity in it. There are some men of God on that station, but there's a lot of wolves on that station. So I don't recommend Christians to watch that. But I watch it because I've been a Christian a long time. The Lord has given me the ability to grow. And so I can watch it and know what's from the Lord and what's from man. Okay? Baptists. For them to even consider if the word of God is infallible. You know, at one time the Baptists were not fighting, but they were talking among each other. Is God's word really infallible? This was going on with the Baptist church. This is an embarrassment for Baptists. I am a Baptist, so I can say these things. I am a Christian. I go to a Baptist church. Let me correct that. I am not a Baptist, but I do go to a Baptist church. And for them to even consider that, it's embarrassing. That's all I have to say. The Methodists, for them to vote whether to have homosexuals as preachers or not. Y'all hear me? Catholics. Catholics need to read the New Testament. That's what they need to do. They need to read the four Gospels. That's what they need to do. Then they go to church and see if what they're doing is right. That's what I have to do. Read the four Gospels and then look at your church and see if you're a church of God. Jessie, you shouldn't be talking about other churches. You know, I'm not talking about the people. I love the people. Catholics, Baptists, Pentecostals. I love the people. I don't like the religion. And I'm going to tell you a little bit ahead of time. My next teaching is going to be all about religion and all about the church. And like I said, I go to a Baptist church, but my loyalty is not into the Baptist church. My loyalty is into my God, my Lord, my Father. That's my loyalty. I praise Him and only Him. I worship Jesus and only Jesus. Because He is perfect. The Baptist church ain't perfect. The Catholic church ain't perfect. The Pentecost, the Methodist, those are not perfect churches. They're run by man. They have men of God in some of those churches. But the man of God, just like David, is not perfect. We still have sin. Psalms 118, verse 8 and 9. It is better to trust in the Lord than to put your confidence in a man. I can't say that enough. I know a lot of people, religious people. And when I talk to them about the words of God, the words of God. Well, my pastor, or my preacher, or my priest, I mean, I don't want to know what your pastor, priest, I don't want to know what he says. I want to know what the word of God says. But they look to them. Instead of going to the word and say, oh, well, the scriptures say. No, they say, well, my religion, they believe. Do you understand where I'm coming from? It is better to trust in the Lord than to put your confidence in a man. It's better to put your trust in the Lord than to put your confidence in a religion. Please be with me next week, because the Lord has given me the scriptures to put religion in its place. These religious leaders, they must not have read Proverbs 18:7. The mouth of fools are their ruin. They trap themselves with their lips. And that's what I've shown this whole teaching. That's all they've been doing. They've been doing exactly what Proverbs 18:7 says.